Hi, today we'll talk about Azure Private Endpoints and Links. My name is Sergey. I am Senior DevOps Engineer in SoftServe. I have two Azure certifications, Certified Azure Developer and Certified Azure Architect Technologies. Here is our today's agenda. Firstly, we'll discuss problems related to cloud PaaS services and why it's important to overcome them. Secondly, we'll review Azure Private Endpoints and Links. Also, we'll talk about additional infrastructure changes needed for implementing them in a correct way. Thirdly, we'll discuss how to deploy to the Azure PaaS services which have private endpoints. Then we'll review a use case of using Azure Private Endpoints, which was implemented on one of my previous projects at customer site. In the end, I plan to devote some time to questions and answers session to get some feedback from you guys. Okay. The problem. Let's firstly review why it's a cool technology, why it's important to use. As you can see from the diagram presented on the slide, Azure PaaS services aren't part of our internal network. If you take a look at SQL PaaS database service, you can find that all communication with it falls via internet. By default, Azure PaaS services aren't part of our VNets, in contrast with virtual machines, which belong to VNet from the beginning. If we plan to build indeed secure and private infrastructure using Azure PaaS services, we have to overcome this disadvantage. There are different ways to achieve this. We can use service endpoints, for example, to communicate to Azure PaaS services. However, it has one significant disadvantage. It's not possible to use service endpoints from on-premise. And also some other disadvantages, but it's like I want to stress on this one. There is another more powerful and universal way to do this, Azure Private Endpoints, which we will discuss today. But firstly, let's clarify what is Azure Private Link, why Azure, Azure Private Endpoint and Azure Private Links are. Just what is this? Azure Private Link is a technology designed to provide private connectivity to selected PaaS services, customer off-net and partner offered services. Okay, it's a technology, it's just general meaning. Private Link allows us to access services over a private endpoint deployed into our virtual network. All traffic privately traverses the Microsoft global backbone, eliminating any exposure to the public internet and increasing security. There's no need for additional network resources such as gateways, NAT devices, and public IP addresses. I need to say that network complexity in this case is also reduced. There are two key components of Azure Private Link, Private Endpoint and Private Link Service. Private Endpoint is a network interface connected to our virtual network, assigned with a private IP address. It's used to connect privately and securely to a service powered by Azure Private Link or a private link service that you or your partner might own. Private Link Service itself represents our own service powered by Azure Private Link that runs behind an Azure standard load balancer. It's important to understand that for Private Link Service, we should have Azure standard load balancer to power it by Private Link Service, enabled for private link access. This service can be privately connected with and consumed using private endpoints deployed in the customer's virtual network. What gives us Azure Private Link Service? Privately access services on the Azure platform. It allows to connect our virtual network to services in Azure without a public IP address as the source or destination. Service providers can render their services in their own virtual network, and consumers can access those services in their local virtual network. The Private Link platform will handle the connectivity between the consumer and services over the Azure backbone network. Secondly, on-premises and peered networks. it helps to access services running in Azure over ExpressRoute, private peering, VPN tunnels, and peered virtual networks using private endpoints. Protection against data leakage, private endpoint is mapped to an instance of a PaaS resource instead to the entire service. Consumers can only connect to the specific resource. Access to any other resource in the service is blocked. This mechanism provides protection against data leakage risks, also reduces security related to using of private endpoints. Global reach, this allows us to connect privately to services running in other regions. The consumer's virtual network could be in region A, and it can connect to services behind private link in region B. Extend to our own services. It means that we can enable the same experience functionality to render our service privately to consumers in Azure. By placing our service behind a standard load balancer, as I told it already, we can enable it for private link. The consumer can then connect directly to our service using a private endpoint in their own virtual network. We can manage the connection requests using an approval call flow, which we will discuss later today. Additionally, need to say that the Azure private link works for consumers and services belonging to different Azure Active Directory tenants. In other words, we can expose our service powered by Azure private link to anybody in Azure, to our customers, and etc. Now let's plunge more deeply into Azure private endpoints. Azure private endpoint is a network interface that connects us privately and securely to a service powered by Azure private link. Private endpoint uses a private IP address from our VNet, effectively bringing the service into the VNet. Azure private endpoints are not free of charge. You can find pricing on the slide. The pricing of a private endpoint depends on amount of inbound, outbound traffic and usage time. It's like a 1 cent per gigabyte of incoming and outgoing traffic and hour of usage. Here are some key details about private endpoints. Private endpoint enables connectivity between the consumers from the same VNet, regionally peered VNets, globally peered VNets, and on-premises using VPN or ExpressRoute. Network connections can only be initiated by clients connecting to the private endpoint. Connections can only be established in a single direction. When creating a private endpoint, a read-only network interface is also created for the lifecycle of the resource. The interface is assigned dynamically private IP address from the subnet that maps to the private link resource. The value of the private IP address remains unchanged for the entire lifecycle of the private endpoint. The private link resource can be deployed in a different region than the virtual network and private endpoint. Multiple private endpoints can be created using the same private link resource for a single network using a common DNS server configuration. However, the recommended practice is to use a single private endpoint for a given private link resource to avoid duplicate entries or conflicts in DNS resolution. We'll talk regarding different DNS setup schemas later today. Multiple private endpoints can be created on the same or different subnets within the same virtual network. There are limits to the number of private endpoints you can create in a subscription. As you can see from the slide, we are limited by 1,000 private endpoints per VNet, by 64,000 per subscription, and by 800 private link services per subscription. a few words about network security of private endpoints. When using private endpoints for Azure services, traffic is secured to a specific private link resource. The platform performs an access control to validate network connections reaching only to the specified private link resource. To access additional resources within the same Azure service, additional private endpoints should be created. We can completely walk down our workloads from accessing public endpoints to connect to a supported Azure service. This control provides an additional network security level to our resources by providing a built-in protection that prevents access to other resources hosted on the same Azure service. As you can see from the slide, we can have multiple VNets and also on-premises resources. And we can have multiple private endpoints as described on the slide. In this case, we have one private endpoint in Europe North and one private endpoint in Europe West VNets. Those VNets can talk to each other, for example, like hub and spoke topology. It's not a problem. Okay. On this slide, you can observe the list of Azure PaaS services which support private endpoints. As you can see, not all Azure services support private links. At the first place in the list, we can find our own private link service. We'll talk a bit more later today. Need to repeat here that we should consider our own private link service as a one which supports private endpoints from the list. Other PaaS, Azure PaaS services you can find on this slide. Need to add here, then if you plan to use Azure private endpoints, you need to check twice from the list on Microsoft portal or in documentation whether it supports private endpoints, because not all Azure services supports. They add some functionality time to time, but please check it before planning or architecting something. It's important. Okay. Now let's review flow. How Opera Overflow, how it works from the customer side and the from service provider side. We can connect to a private link resource using the following connection approval methods: automatic and manual. Automatic request approved when we own or have permission on the specific private link resource. In other words, if we added to IAM roles on both the private link service and on our customer side, and then the approval will be automatic. Just need to click a few buttons. But if we don't have RBAC control on the service provider side, then manual request, an approval workflow will be initiated manually. The private endpoint and subsequent private endpoint connection will be created in a pending state. The private link resource owner is responsible for approving the connection. After it's approved, the private endpoint is enabled to send traffic normally, as shown in the following diagram. As you can see, the first step, firstly, we should have our support, private link resource. Then, at the service consumer side, at the customer side, it's possible to create private endpoint by specifying the full resource URI or so-called alias. Then the request is sent to the provider side for approval. As I told you, if RBAC permissions exist, then it happens automatically. If no, then the decisions should be made on the support the service provider side. Okay, the private link resource owner can perform the following actions over a private endpoint connection. It's regarding our approve or reject. Review all private endpoint connections in details on the service provider side. Approve a private endpoint connection, reject a private endpoint connection, or even delete a private endpoint connection in any state, whether it's approved or rejected. After this decision is sent to the consumer side, Then after that, in the step four, connection is approved or rejected. If it's approved, then client can work with a service via private endpoint in approved state. If no, then it's inactive in rejected state. After that is additional step. It's item number five. Customer can configure DNS record for easy access using the private IP address of a private endpoint. I need to say that most of Azure PaaS services need DNS. Some of them, access directly via IP address, but mostly of them asks for DNS. Okay, one note. Only a private endpoint in an approval state can send traffic to a given private link resource. Just if it's approved, it should be approved, then it works. A few words about DNS configuration. When connecting to a private link resource using a fully qualified domain name as part of the connection string, it's important to correctly configure our DNS settings to resolve the allocated private IP address. Existing Azure services might already have a DNS configuration to use when connecting over a public endpoint. This needs to be overridden to connect using our private endpoint. Just we'll talk about this more deeply later today. The network interface associated with the private endpoint contains the complete set of information required to configure our DNS, including FQDN and private IP addresses allocated for a given private link resource. NSG is not supported on private endpoints. While subnets containing the private endpoint can have NSG associated with it, network security groups, the rules will not be effective on traffic processed by private endpoint. Also, we must have network policies enforcement disabled deployed to private endpoints. Just also important to note that on the subnet level, it should be disabled. However, NSG is still enforced on other workloads hosted on the same subnet. In other words, just if we have other virtual machines, NSG would be effective, but not to Azure private endpoints. Okay, now let's talk more deeply regarding private link service. Azure private link service is a reference to our own service that is powered by Azure private link. Just consider it like our own service, which we can power via private endpoints and via private link. Our service that's running behind Azure standard load balancer can be enabled for private link access so that consumers to our service can access it privately from their own VNets. The consumers can create a private endpoint inside their VNet and map it to the service. Azure private link service is only supported on standard load balancer, just to stress. After we create a private link service, Azure will generate a global unique named Monica, called alias, based on the name we provide for our service. We can share either the alias or resource URI, as I told you on the previous slide, of our service with our consumers offline. Consumers can start a private link connection using the alias or the resource URI. Just a few details about Azure Private Link Services. Private Link Services can be accessed from approved private endpoints in any public region. The private endpoint can be reached from the same virtual network, regionally peered VNets, globally peered VNets, and on-premises using private VPN or express route connections. When creating a private link service, a network interface is created for the lifecycle of the resource. This interface is not manageable by the customer, it's read-only. The private link service must be deployed in the same region as the virtual network and the standard load balancer. A single private link service can be accessed from multiple private endpoints belonging to different VNets, subscriptions, and or Active Directory tenants. The connection is established through a connection workflow. Multiple private link services can be created on the same standard load balancer using different front-end IP configurations. there are limits to the number of private link services we can create per standard word balancer and per subscription. We have discussed limits previously already. Okay. What is alias? Alias is a globally unique name for our service. It helps us to mask the customer data for our service and at the same time creates an easy to share name for our service. When we create a private link service, Azure generates an alias for our service that we can share with our customers. The customers can use this alias to request a connection to our service. The alias is composed of three parts. It's like a prefix, .guid, .suffix. Prefix is the service name. We can pick up our own prefix. After alias is created, we can change it, only recreate. GUID will be provided by a platform. This helps to make the name globally unique. Suffix is appended by Azure. It's like a region.azure.privatelinkService. Complete alias will look like alias prefix.guid. .region.azure.privatelinkService. Just let's pay some attention to the slide provided. As you can see on the at the right of the screen, here we have our own Azure service. It's like a set of VMs, just it doesn't matter. It could be some web farm, maybe some processing. It's just dependent to our architecture. In front of it, we have a standard load balancer, And also then we can create Azure private link service on top of it. And then create private endpoints in any Azure subscription or even Active Directory tenant from any site and reach privately to our service. It's like a private use case, of our private service. At the moment, Microsoft allows us to create such connections using private endpoints to their PaaS services. Okay. Now let's review more our private link service creation workflow. On this slide, we can observe the creation workflow of private link service. Firstly, we have a configure our applications to run behind a standard load balancer. Secondly, we need to create a private link service and attach it to the standard load balancer front-end IP configuration. Then we should share resource URI alias with our customers. We already touched this point in one of our previous slides. After that, our consumers should create private endpoints using information provided. Also, customers may configure their DNS records to point to private IP addresses of private endpoints. Service provider should approve reject customer's request. Eventually, connections become approved rejected. Approved connections are ready to accept incoming traffic, while rejected ones are inactive. Just it's a general flow of how it works from provisioning to working infrastructure. Okay, now let's begin talking about DNS configuration. Azure Private Endpoint DNS configuration. It's important to correctly configure our DNS settings to resolve the private endpoint IP address to the fully qualified domain name of the connection stream. Existing Microsoft Azure services might already have a DNS configuration for a public endpoint to reach from internet. Yeah. This configuration must be overridden to connect using our private endpoint. The network interface associated with the private endpoint contains the information to configure DNS. The network interface information includes FQDN and private IP address for our private link resource. We can use the following options to configure our DNS settings for private endpoints. Using the host file, using private DNS zone, and use our own DNS forwarder. We can use the hosts file on a virtual machine to override the DNS settings. It's only recommended for testing purposes. It's like Windows System 32, drivers, etc, hosts file. Just you can put any name there and private IP address. And in this way it will work, but only on our VM. Very useful for testing purposes or for some development purposes. Second approach, we can use private DNS zones to override the DNS resolution for a private endpoint. A private DNS zone can be linked to our virtual network to resolve specific domains. So on VNet level. Third option, we can use a DNS forwarder to override the DNS resolution for a private link resource. To achieve this, we have to create a DNS forwarding rule to use a private DNS zone on the DNS server hosted in Azure virtual network. Important to keep in mind, it's not recommended to override a zone that's actively in use to resolve public endpoints. Connections to resources won't be able to resolve correctly without DNS forwarding to the public DNS. It's important to keep in mind that we should set up a conditional forwarding. We'll talk a bit later regarding this, not to create stub zone in our internal DNS. Our applications don't need to change the connection URL. When resolving to a public DNS service, the DNS server will resolve to our private endpoints. The process doesn't affect our existing applications. Okay, now let's review a few configuration scenarios. There are three main approaches in configuring DNS for using Azure private endpoints. Virtual network workloads without custom DNS server. In this case, we use only our private DNS zone attached to VNet. Second, on-premises workloads using a DNS forwarder. In this case, we use a special VM, or we can use some Azure service like a firewall. It also allows us to set up DNS forwarder there. But prefer it to use VM to resolve private endpoints DNS names. Virtual network and on-premises workloads using a DNS forwarder. In this case, we use DNS forwarders to resolve private endpoints DNS names both in Azure and on-prem. We'll review it in more details in upcoming slides. Okay, let's discuss the first scenario. It's virtual network workloads without custom DNS server. This configuration is appropriate for virtual network workloads without a custom DNS server. In this scenario, the client queries for the private endpoint IP address to the Azure provided DNS service. I will remind you, it's 168.63.129.16. This IP address is used to resolve Azure DNS. Azure DNS will be responsible for DNS resolution of the private DNS zones. As you can see from the slide, we have the following infrastructure, Azure VNet, database service, and VM inside this VNet. At the first step, VNet itself queries for the FQDN, for the DNS, issues DNS request to our Azure provided DNS. Second step, DNS, Azure provided DNS uses its own Azure recursive resolvers to find the appropriate resolution. Eventually, it finds a private DNS zone, which we set, had to set up in link to VNet, and then issues response. Eventually, the response comes to VM in item number 4. And VM, after that, when it got a DNS response, is able to talk to Azure database service via Azure private endpoint. Just in this case, we also can use hosts file, for example, but Azure DNS is more reliable solution. Need to say that we can't talk to Azure SQL database service without only using IP address. It's not possible. It uses aliases to connect, and just we have to use a DNS name to connect there. Okay, we can extend this model to peered virtual networks associated to the same private endpoint. In this case, we had to add new virtual network links to the private DNS zones for all peered virtual networks. Need to admit that a single private DNS zone is required for this configuration. Creating multiple zones with the same name for different virtual networks, we can create in VNetSys, would need manual operations to merge DNS records. Will work, but not good approach. Okay, second scenario, on-premises workloads using a DNS forwarder. For on-premises workloads to resolve the FQDN of a private endpoint, we can use a DNS forwarder to resolve the Azure service, public DNS zone in Azure. The following scenario is for an on-premises network that has a DNS forwarder in Azure. This forwarder resolves DNS queries via server-level forwarder to the Azure-provided DNS with the same IP address, 168.63.129.16. The following diagram illustrates the DNS resolution sequence for an on-premises network. The configuration uses the DNS forwarder deployed in Azure. And also the resolution is made by a private DNS zone linked to a virtual network. Now let's review a bit the slide. And you can see from the slide, we have here a VNet and also on-premises network, which connected via VPN or express route. The first step, our VNet issues, our client VM issues request to DNS forwarder. It just uses the Azure DNS as it can use it directly as a DNS server, or we'll talk a bit later, it can set up a conditional forwarder in on-premises DNS configuration. After that, DNS forwarder talks to Azure provided DNS. And then Azure provided DNS uses Azure recursive resolvers to resolve it to private DNS zone. Then we get the answer. And eventually, DNS forwarder returns answer to client VM. And client VM, then on-premises client VM, can talk to Azure SQL database service where our private network using a VPN or express route just internally without any exposure of traffic to the internet. Need to say that this configuration can be extended for an on-premises network that already has a DNS solution. It's more like a viable because on-prem infrastructure already exists before we create some Azure resources. Most common scenario in place. In this case, the on-premises DNS solution should be configured to forward DNS traffic to Azure DNS via conditional forwarder. In, for example, Windows DNS, we can open DNS and there is a, on the console, there is an option, like a folder, conditional forwarding. And we should set up conditional forwarding for our particular services zones to that DNS forwarder to Azure. The conditional forwarder reference to the DNS forwarder deployed in Azure. And another one, DNS configuration scenario, virtual network and on-premises workloads using the DNS forwarder. For workloads accessing a private endpoint from virtual and on-premises network, we can use the DNS forwarder to resolve the Azure-specific public DNS zone deployed in Azure. The following scenario is for an on-premises network with virtual networks in Azure also. Both networks access the private endpoint located in a shared hub network. This DNS forwarder is responsible for resolving all the DNS queries via server-level forwarder to the Azure-provided DNS service. The following diagram shows the DNS resolution for both networks, on-premises and virtual networks, Azure virtual networks. The solution is using a DNS forwarder. The resolution is made by a private DNS zone linked to a virtual network. Let's review the slide. As you can see, we have here hub and spoke topology in Azure. We have VNet Hub 001 in the center, our hub network, and also Spoke network, which is located, for example, in different region. And also we have on-premise infrastructure, which is connected to our hub network via VPN Express route. Need to add here that most of large enterprises uses similar model of on-premises and Azure networking. They have one central hub network and several or more spoke networks in different regions. Okay, at the first step, our client on-premise client VM and the client VM in spoke VNet issues requests through DNS forwarder. Then DNS forwarder asks Azure DNS service. Azure DNS service uses Azure request resolvers to find our private DNS zone. Then answer is returned to DNS forwarder, and DNS forwarder returns answer to client spoke VM and client VM, client VM in spoke VNet and to on-premises client VM. After that, both our VMs are able to talk to Azure SQL database pass service via DNS name. Now let's pay several minutes to reviewing deployment to Azure PaaS services securely via private endpoints. From the deployment standpoint, there are some restrictions from Azure side when using private endpoints. Since that public access to Azure resources with private endpoints is restricted, we don't have a site of visibility to those resources. In this case, we have to use deployment agents inside a private network address space. The traffic is routed to private endpoints and all actions are happening via private endpoints. Another question is DNS. Since we use private DNS zones for private endpoints, our resources aren't exposed to internet. I mean, they don't have public DNS. When we are in internal network, we are able to use internal DNS and reach to private endpoints. As you can see from the slide, we have some on-premises network and Azure networks connected via VPN or Express route. And we also have some Azure DevOps, for example, somewhere in internet, in cloud, not installed locally. In this case, we can't, use, for example, cloud hosted agents deploy to our web application. What we can do, what we can sync up in this case, we may place our so-called Azure DevOps self-hosted agents on on-premise network, as you can see here. And also we can, I didn't draw it, but we can place another one in Azure subnet also, in some of VNet, Azure VNets. In this case, we will have the site of visibility to our private endpoint, private IP address. And also we will be able to resolve DNS, private DNS names to the right private IP addresses. And in this way, we can deploy to our PaaS services powered by Azure Private Links. Only from internal network need to sync up in this way. Okay. Now I would like to share some practical use case of Azure Private Endpoints. Let's review one practical example, which I implemented a few months ago. There was migration of the application from on-prem to Azure. In terms of the migration, I've proposed a new PaaS Azure infrastructure instead of an old on-prem one for dev and QA environments. Need to say that stage and production environments were in Azure already, and dev and QA were on-prem, sharing the same VM. Moreover, both IS web server and MS SQL server were on the one VM. You can find old architecture of dev and QA environments on the slide. Environments had only internal access. As you can see, there were three web applications for dev and also three web applications for QA environments. Also database for dev and database for QA environments. All IIS and MS SQL were installed on the same VM with the following system requirements, like for vCPUs and 16 GB of RAM. Yeah, it was built in this way. What was proposed? New architecture has several advantages if compare it to the old one. You can find it on the slide. Firstly, we moved out from IIS model to PaaS model, which allows us to get rid of some maintenance activities like patching. Secondly, we got almost the same architecture as it's used for upper environments. In our case, ACE, so-called application service environment, plus Azure SQL, we are using for upper environments already. It allowed us to use the same deployment flow for dev and queue environments. We adjusted pipelines and they became the same as for upper environments. Eventually, we have the same deployment flow across all applications environments. Private endpoints allowed us to connect Azure App Services into our private network and access it via private IP addresses. You need to say that it was one of the functional requirements from the organization to have only private access to our to all environments, no any public access. Azure Application Services were integrated with VNet, and all internal services like SMTP relay were accessible to the application. Need to repeat here that where private endpoints, Azure services accessible only for incoming requests. For outgoing requests, we have to sync up a way of communication, Azure PaaS services to our internal resources. For app services, VNet is the VNet integration is a good option in this case, at least. It's possible also to use a hybrid connection, but in this case, due to this architecture, it was, I think, best solution. Azure SQL database was accessible via service endpoint to the application. Firstly, application services traffic is routed to VNet, and then it's routed to Azure SQL server via service endpoint enabled on an integration subnet. There is no external access to Azure application services when private endpoints enabled on the service. If you additionally need to enable external access to it, we can create a load balancer, for example, and connect it to a private endpoint. And these DNS changes were made on internal DNS only. In this case, because we just roll down local A entries for our websites, for our web applications. I need to say that we use it custom certificate, not Microsoft provided. And that's why it was an option just to create a few more local DNS entries for our websites in internal DNS zone. Additionally, I have to say that it was possible to use application services environment for dev and queue environments also. However, in this case, the price would be increased by approximately $1,000 per month per 1 ACE. And in this particular case, private endpoints helped customers to save significant amount of money. As you can see from the infrastructure architecture diagram, we use private endpoints only to access to web applications. Access to database services is used happens via service endpoints. But in this case also, all traffic traverses only over our VNet and hits database server just from the inside of Azure. Now it's a turn of questions and answers. Just if you have any, please go ahead.